Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.
Good day, ladies and gentlemen. Welcome to another edition of Centering on Peace. Centering on Peace is brought to you on the second Tuesday of every month by the Berks Peace Community. The Peace Community is a long-time community, a peace group in this area, dating back at least to the Vietnam War, and some say before that. We are not as strong as we once were, but we're equally devoted to the cause. And besides this program, every Friday, we have a vigil on the Penn Street Bridge, just down the road from the studio. In winter, from 8 to 9 a.m., and in summer, after the clocks change, from 5 to 6 p.m. We welcome you there. You'd be surprised at the excellent reception we get, and we've been greeted even more warmly since this appalling slaughter in Gaza, is the only way to put it. So please come. Today we're going to be talking about the military-industrial complex that has played such a central role in U.S. life. And my guest tonight, today, Brad Wolf, who is one of the organizers of the Merchants of Death War Crimes Tribunal, and remotely, Liam Ramsey, yes, who is the an organizer at Kirkridge Retreat Center in the Poconos, and a longtime peace activist. So welcome to Centering on Peace, both of you.
Thank you.
So Brad, I'd like you to start off by explaining just briefly how you got to be where you are today as part of this war crimes tribunal. I'd be very interested to hear your sort of path.
Sure. Thank you, and thank you for having me today.
Yeah.
I'm an attorney and a former prosecutor, and I went into prosecution because I thought public service might be a way to facilitate justice and peace in the world, and quickly realized that politics and elected office was not going to be a way to facilitate that. And so, after a period of practicing law and being in academia, I was able to dedicate all of my time to the areas of anti-war and peace activism. And so through that, I was able to meet a number of people in the last, say, 10 years and get involved in this Merchants of Death War Crimes Tribunal 2 years ago. And that was through Kathy Kelly, Nick Modern, and myself. We're sitting around about 2 years ago. We were all in a group called Band Killer Drones. And we started talking about the need to have a people's tribunal, sort of like the Bertrand Russell Tribunal of the 1960s, which held accountable the American government for atrocities in Vietnam. And we thought a people's tribunal holding accountable weapons manufacturers for commission in war crimes and crimes against humanity would be appropriate and would be valuable because it would put the focus on the money. And we thought profit drives war to a large degree. So if we could shine a light on the war profiteers and how they influence decision making in the halls of Congress, in the executive branch, and in the Pentagon, and then also reveal the great money that they're making off of so much suffering, we thought that could be beneficial to the debate about peace and social justice. So we started all this, and we're about halfway through it right now.
Great. I mean, it's an amazing story. Liam, how about you? Where have you been the last however many years, and what have you been doing?
Well, I entered the peace movement during the Vietnam War. I graduated from high school in 1966, so I was part of the group of young men who were eligible to be drafted at that point, and I found a office of the American Friends Service Committee, which helped me with some draft counseling. And basically, I became a draft resister, not a CO, but a draft resister during the war. I also have been a part of war tax resistance. Also, I've been on the coordinating committee for National War Tax Resistance Coordinating Committee. So I've been doing that since I've been doing war tax resistance since 1972. I worked for the American Friends Service Committee in the Southeast as a regional coordinator of peace work, and then in St. Louis as an area person. So it was 5 years in the Southeast, and then 17 years in St. Louis working for the American Friends Service Committee. And through that, I had a lot of experience working with what we back then called economic conversion projects, efforts to convert military facilities to civilian products rather than military products, and worked a great deal on the military, the nuclear facilities around the country. And actually, we had five or six of them in the Southeast. So in the 70s, we were trying to get those, understand the nuclear weapons complex and its duplication and its dominance in whole regions of the country. So that has been my work. I've done projects both related to military interventions. I've worked with Kathy Kelly a great deal back in the early 90s. And we did in St. Louis a People's Tribunal, War Crimes Tribunal, in 1993. And I can talk a little bit more about that later. But the idea of a tribunal coming out of the Russell Tribunals in the UK during the Vietnam War was always there in the background, but this was our first attempt in St. Louis as a peace community, a peace and justice community, to try to conduct a tribunal.
Great. So can you describe how the tribunal works, Brad?
Sure. A people's tribunal is not a legal tribunal, so it doesn't have the legal authority, but what it does have is the involvement of the citizens. And the citizens decide that when the government is not responsive, they're going to act. And it's often through an anger or even an outrage at the failure of the government to act and to respond. And so what we've done is we've decided to use the legal process in order to communicate a lot of information about weapons manufacturers and what they do and the crimes that they commit. So we began interviewing retired military officers, military analysts, victims of war, journalists, researchers, lawyers, even theologians, to all put the pieces in place and build the evidence for a case to prove that U.S. weapons manufacturers are guilty of war crimes and crimes against humanity as defined by the Rome Statute of the International Criminal Court. And what we did is we picked four U.S. weapons manufacturers to be representative of the entire U.S. weapons industry. And we picked Raytheon, which is now known as RTX, Lockheed Martin, Boeing, and then we picked the drone maker General Atomics because we wanted to bring drone warfare into the conversation, into the debate. So they're not the only U.S. weapons manufacturers by any stretch, but they are representative of the great deal of problems and the suffering that's caused. So what we've done is we serve them with subpoenas. Approximately a year ago, we went down to Washington, D.C., and we served them with subpoenas.
How do you serve them with subpoenas? You walk in the front door and say...
Exactly. So what we did is I relied on my background as a prosecutor, and we have a panel of judges who are made up of attorneys as well who helped us draft a subpoena. And so we drafted a legal subpoena, you know, according to the format, and a group of us went down and we walked in the front door and put the subpoena down on the desk and asked that they send down a representative of the legal department to receive service of our subpoena. Sometimes they did, Sometimes they didn't. We were met with police and escorted off the property. But when they failed to comply with our subpoena, we returned 90 days later and issued contempt citations to them. So the idea was to keep the pressure on and to use the legal process in a manner that would hold them accountable as best we could. And the way we've been communicating our evidence is we had interviews and have filmed these interviews and created video documentaries. And every week, we've been releasing video documentaries that evidence the crimes these companies are committing. And so if you go to merchantsofdeath.org, you will see all the evidence on there, and approximately 25 to 30 minute videos. They're digestible. You can watch them after work or during a commute, and you can see as we're building the case against these, which is all going towards a verdict, which will be rendered in May.
I must say, I found them, I watched a couple, I found them incredibly moving. And so I think it's great work. And then you put them up on Rumble, right?
We do.
Okay, Rumble is a platform like YouTube,
right.
Except not like YouTube. Liam, do you have anything you want to say to Brad's, or want to add to Brad's?
Yes. We had similar experiences of trying to deliver summonses and also deliver indictments. At one point, we were part of a, in St. Louis, we were part of an effort with some people in North Carolina, which ended up presenting an indictment to a CIA front that was running torture flights as a part of the it was the program that the CIA was operating, basically going around the world, finding people
black sites
and taking them to torture sites where they could be tortured before bringing them to Guantanamo here. And on several occasions, we presented U.S. officials with subpoenas and indictments, but in that one case, we actually presented it to the CIA front in an airport in rural North Carolina.
Interesting. Well, one of the things I learned was from watching the videos was that that the scale of the international arms trade is just unbelievable. And we've already mentioned the Pentagon budget's huge role in U.S. life. But perhaps you can talk a little bit. Well, before you do that, let me say that one of the questions that came to my mind was that, okay, let's say the U.S. is angry at the Houthi rebels for firing on ships in the Red Sea. And they drop bombs on supposedly only on military targets. But why is it that the weapons manufacturers are held accountable for civilian deaths when they aren't the ones ordering the strikes?
Sure. So what we allege is that they're co-conspirators in the deaths of those civilians. Mm-hmm. And to say that they're co-conspirators means that they know that their products are being used to kill innocents. And that's quite clear. Anybody reading the paper knows that these weapons are killing lots of innocents. You can look at Gaza and the genocide that's occurring there. You can see it happening in Ukraine. And wherever wars are fought, civilians die. And the weapons that these manufacturers produce have that result. They know that. They continue to produce them, but they don't just continue to produce them. Through their lobbying efforts in Congress and through their funding of think tanks and academia, they create a narrative in the media that promotes war and makes it appear as if a military option is the only option available. And they do that so they can sell their products. So they are fomenting war needlessly in order to increase their bottom line. That's why we're holding them accountable.
Right. And I guess the other part of it is that they also have said to their publics in the different countries in which weapons are manufactured that, you know, they're much more accurate nowadays. It's been saying that since the Vietnam War, at least. No civilians, we can pinpoint this and that, but it turns out to be mostly untrue. Is that accurate?
It is. When they say that these are surgical strikes and that there are precision weapons, precision guided bombs, even the term smart bombs is, these are just euphemisms designed to allay public fears about innocent people dying. When you're dropping paveway bombs, which Lockheed Martin makes, and some of those bombs are made up in the Lockheed Martin plant in Scranton, Pennsylvania, when you're dropping paveway bombs in urban areas, hospitals, schools, and refugee centers are hit.
So paveway, what is paveway?
Paveway is a type of a particular type of bomb that is used. They're called paveway bombs. They're basically paving the way for the troops to come in.
Oh.
And that's the name of the bomb, but they are highly destructive devices. And again, the thought that they're precise and that they're only killing bad guys is just, it's a false narrative. Mm-hmm. It's one that is perpetuated in the media when you see these films of these laser-guided bombs taking off and you think that they're going to hit the exact target, and clearly they don't.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yes, really horrific. So in order to illustrate the depth of militarism in this country, how, Liam, what examples can you think of that would raise people's consciousness about the extent to which militarism affects everyday life in the U.S.?
Yeah. Well, I think what we've done over the last few months here in eastern Pennsylvania to expose this what looks like a very small company of 80 employees, but expose their role in the larger corporations that they serve in providing guidance systems, basically these displays for armaments like Brad has just been speaking of, what are called smart bombs or weapons that have so supposedly precise targeting. And there is no precise targeting in the war. And the automation of war also is a part of that. If you go to Elbit, which is the Israeli defense contractor, military contractor, arms producer, that that Aiden is a part of.
Aiden is the local.
The managers out there corrected our pronunciation of that at our last demonstration, but it is Aiden. Thank you. And we decided early on that we would try to, first of all, research what Aiden was up to and what they were doing, particularly related to the attacks on Gaza. And as you know, John, we found out a great deal of information. The American Friends Service Committee has a corporate, I think they call them a corporate investigative unit in their San Francisco office, where they catalog all many defense contractors and the weapons they're providing and the uses that they're making of them in various countries. So we used that research and found out that Aiden was producing these display screens, which are then put in tanks, in artillery units, in drones, in planes, in missiles, and in drones. And that they are being used in Gaza, or weapons or screens like them are being used. We have not been able to get anybody to admit that these particular screens made at this particular place are placed on weapons that are then deployed in Gaza. And there are many reasons why we can't get that information, because the United States government and the Pentagon have no interest in letting large numbers of people know where weapons are produced and where they go from there, where they're stockpiled, and where they're delivered to a combat situation. Mm-hmm. But so we took that information, We created a leaflet, and our first attempt, as you know, John, was to try to convey our concerns about the products they were making to the workers at the Iden plant. And we went a week ago today, actually, several of you in the area attempted to meet workers as they were reaching work, and actually talked with one management official as well as two or three other workers. And our hope was to explain to the workers that we're not after their livelihood. We want them to be making things that produce things that are needed in our country and other countries around the world. But we want them to understand that they could, as workers in this industry, be cited as co-conspirators in crimes against humanity and in war crimes. And the, as we've seen in the recent tribunals, also my 76-year-old mind is blanking on what we're...
I hear you.
Yeah, well, the genocide tribunal that took place, or hearing that took place at the World Court is an example of that. The Center for Constitutional Rights also filed a suit in a San Francisco federal court citing the United States government as violating the genocide covenants that were made after World War II. In St. Louis, we actually held a tribunal in 1993, right after the first war against Iraq, and it was based on an indictment, or if you will, a set of probation conditions that we believed that the United States government ought to be on. And those probation conditions were printed in an op-ed piece in the Post-Dispatch, calling people to a April 4th, 1993 tribunal. And we had Richard Falk come out from Princeton University. He was still there, and he was the prosecutor. And we had about five international people living in St. Louis who served as the international tribunal, the judges. And we had conveners of the, which was a way of getting hundreds of people signed on as conveners of this tribunal. And we heard the evidence not only about what U.S. government had done in terms of its invasions of Nicaragua, Panama, and Iraq, but also the way in which money that could be available to communities here is ciphered off into the military-industrial complex, and that that itself was causing harm to people here in this country. So we had a sort of broad approach, and we held the tribunal, and we came up with that of course that they were guilty of crimes against humanity and war crimes, and then we took that indictment to the U.S. attorney in St. Louis and requested that he conduct an investigation of what we had found. And so it was sort of a mock tribunal. Mm-hmm. It didn't have the force of any particular legal entity, but it was a people's tribunal. And as I said, we also at times presented other indictments and subpoenas to public officials when they would visit in St. Louis as speakers at public forums. So when Henry Kissinger visited St. Louis to speak in the World Speakers Program that was hosted at the Symphony Hall by the local public television and radio station and by the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, we set up a picket line outside there. The Spanish government, the Spanish court, had indicted Kissinger and for his crimes, particularly against the Chilean people in putting together the coup in 1973. And so we were visiting that. This was way into the 90s, I think, when we did this. We found a stage door and we positioned five of us at the stage door while the rest were picketing out front and others people were going into the forum in an attempt to ask him questions about the indictment. And we had a copy of the indictment on scene. And when he finally showed up after we waited and waited at the stage door, he showed up 10 minutes before he was supposed to speak and there wasn't any security. So I went up to the door and opened the door for him and said, Dr. Kissinger, I'm here on behalf of a Spanish court and we'd like to take you to Madrid so that you could be held accountable for what you did to the Chilean people. And I handed him the indictment. Well, he was, I think, quite surprised and flustered for a moment or two. And then I gave him my arm to help him get out of the limousine, and then security started showing up, and they figured out what had happened to him. But anyway, those were attempts we made to use what are normally called legal processes to confront and to challenge power. And I'm so glad that the tribunal now, the Merchants of Death Tribunal, has put forth this as a major strategy for the peace movement.
Let me reintroduce everybody to the viewers. You've been listening to Liam Ramsey. He's a longtime peace activist now at Kirkridge Retreat Center in the Poconos. And my other guest in the studio is Brad Wolf, who's one of the organizers of the
Merchants of Death, War Crimes Tribunal.
War Crimes Tribunal. It's quite a mouthful. It's very interesting and moving what people are doing. And I think the main point seems to be to draw attention to an area of society that's normally not looked at with any degree of rigor at all. For example, the military budget just sails through. Everybody says we can't afford anything, we can't afford this, we can't afford that. Nobody questions the military budget. How can that be? So I think John Pilger, one of the interviews that you had, was talking about propaganda and silence as the two strategies they use to keep attention off the fact that all of this is going on. And we live here. Main Street of Reading is right outside. Looks normal. There's no suggestion of the military goings on all around us, except, although I haven't seen it in Reading, that a number of police forces, many, many police forces, most notably in Ferguson, in Liam's neck of the woods at the time, had weapons of war straight from the Pentagon that they didn't want anymore, so they give them to the local police departments. And so that's why you get tanks and huge armored vehicles, you know, when they're just civilians walking around, some of them not doing good, but do they really deserve a tank? So perhaps you could talk a bit about propaganda and silence and what do you feel like you've got John's thoughts in your mind?
I do, and it was a pleasure to interview John Pilger. You know, he's a giant of journalism, and he's been sort of sussing out that idea of propaganda. And the U.S. military is very good at hiding its wars. And they do that through propaganda. If you look at CNN or Fox or MSNBC, CBS, any of these networks, the analysts that the mainstream media ask to comment on war are out of the Pentagon. So you know what the narrative is going to be. And when the reporters for these networks are embedded with the troops, they're embedded for a reason, in order to repeat the propaganda that is issued through the Pentagon. So John Pilger was one of those journalists who did not do that. He went in himself in order to find the stories. But this is a culture of militarism in America. It is everywhere. It's on our sports televisions. When you look at any NFL game, there is the tribute to the military and the flyover and everything like that. It is embedded in our movies. Anybody who wants to make a movie using military hardware has to run the gauntlet of the Pentagon production department that approves any script. And so it's in our movies, it's in our TV shows. It's really hard to escape this militarism. And as you said, it's in our police forces. So the excess military material is given to domestic police forces to use on U.S. civilians. And that creates a very scary environment. It's a productive environment for the weapons manufacturers who see their bottom lines continue to grow, but it's a very bad development for citizens of the United States who see things like education and healthcare and homes being out of reach for them because so much of our money, so much of our tax dollars goes to the Pentagon. We're coming up on April 15th, tax day, right? Day everybody hates to fork over their hard-earned cash. And when you think about how much of your money is going to the Pentagon, over $1 trillion a year when everything is combined, in order to make war. And if you look at the State Department, which is our department tasked with peace and diplomacy, they get $60 billion a year. So not even one-tenth of what the Pentagon is getting for making war. So there's a real problem with that dynamic. And what we hope to do through the tribunals and other actions is draw attention to that, change minds, change hearts, motivate people to action.
We do have a slide or graphic that I think we can put up, which has to do with the military budget's share of the U.S. budget. Is it possible? There it is on your screen. You will see in the top half, the red half, almost 50% goes on either current military or past military, which is almost 50% of the budget, which is just staggering. And yet nobody, not nobody, but almost nobody in the Congress or in the Senate, they don't oppose it. It just sails through. Can you think of any notable exceptions?
No, I
can't.
Even
Bernie?
No, I can't. I mean, Bernie promoted the F-35s because they were going to be based in Vermont. So there's a reason they don't oppose this, and that's because these weapons manufacturers contribute to these elected officials. So if you're a congressperson or a senator, you're going to get large donations from the weapons manufacturers. And if you oppose them, you're going to get hit with the money that they're going to fund to your opponent. So it's that's sort of the nefarious nature of these weapons manufacturers. When we allege that they control the halls of Congress, It's true. You know, they have an entree into meetings and into the offices of congressmen and senators and into the Pentagon that they should not have, because we're talking about the constitutional power to declare war. And that's a power that really resides with the people through our elected representatives. It should not reside with the weapons manufacturers.
We still don't. I mean, it's become sort of given since at least the Iraq War, and probably before that, that the House doesn't get a say in whether or not we're going to deploy troops here, there, and ever. The President just has to say it, and lo and behold, it's gone. And at the same time, I have to say, just when the whole world should be concentrating on climate change and getting together to solve an existential threat, we're off fighting wars that over oil frequently, that, you know, it's just, how do we get from here to there? And one of the strengths, I think, of what the tribunals is the emphasis on nonviolence. Mm-hmm. That is really, do you want to talk about nonviolence, Liam?
Well, yes, I feel that we don't put very many resources into the substantial evidence that we have that nonviolence has in fact worked when it's been applied. And but in the many cases, it's given up on and seen as useless because we do not carry it out in a thorough manner and do not take serious the processes of negotiation, the processes of making governments change policy through a process of nonviolence. And I think that nonviolence is, as Gandhi said, an experiment in truth. And what the tribunal here is doing is an experiment in truth. They're trying to put truth out before the American public and have it have consequences for those who are perpetrating these weapon systems and the wars we fight with them. And you're right about the undeclared nature of most wars that the United States has fought since World War II. And even the ones that there was a vote in Congress on, they were manipulated votes because the Gulf of Tonkin resolution, for instance, that supposedly authorized the Johnson administration to deploy troops and begin war in Vietnam, was based on a pure fabrication of an incident in the Gulf of Tonkin that did not take place. And so that is another way in which the United States government depends on propaganda and a dishonest presentation of information in order to get the action that they want out of the American people. And so we have to be very, very careful of what we accept as truth and then act upon it once we know what the real truth is. And it could have saved thousands, hundreds of thousands, millions of lives in Vietnam if we had not gone in as we did in 1964 and 65 and then through to 1975.
Yeah, if I could comment on nonviolence as a technique, what Liam says is absolutely right. It's effective. Mm-hmm. It works. And Erica Chenoweth is a scholar and author who recently put out a book that demonstrates, she examined conflicts over the last 100 years and found that when nonviolence was used, they were far more likely to succeed in meeting their goals than when violence was used. So some people come at nonviolence because it's through their faith. But it's not necessarily to be a person of faith in order to use nonviolence and recognize that it works, that it's very effective. The establishment is very good at fighting wars. They know how to do it. They've been doing it forever. But they don't know how to deal with nonviolence. And so that's why it's so often successful. That's why we choose to do it. I'm a Catholic. I come at it through the tradition of Philip Berrigan and Daniel Berrigan and Dorothy Day. And I believe that that's the right way to do it. And it's the effective way to do it.
Mm-hmm. Well, it just so happens that Brad has written a book about Philip Berrigan, which I don't know how many people remember him now, but he was really an extraordinary, and his brother, and his, one of them, children.
Yes, Frieda Berrigan.
Frieda. Anyway, there it is, a Ministry of Risk. Unfortunately, I can't see which camera is on me, which is unfortunate, or on the book. But anyway, there it is.
There it is, yes.
A Ministry of Risk, and Philip Berrigan, of course, was, and there were a long line of people with him and since him who would spill their blood on the nose cones of missiles, climb into military bases, spill their blood to say, no more, stop this, we got to stop it, we cannot keep doing this. You know, the choices between non-violence and non-existence, as signs say on the street. And that really is true. I mean, you know, one of the things that Pilcher said in his interview was that if you think AI is dangerous, check out its use in the military.
Yeah.
And his use in the military was this startling vision of a swarm of drones coming at you. guided by artificial intelligence. How do you fight that? And then, of course, you've got the nukes, and that's the other thing that is completely kept silent, as far as I know, or maybe not completely, because there was whatever his name was, Vanunu, in Israel, who let out the fact that Israel has nukes. Actually, people did know it because there was a whole thing in South Africa with nukes and Israel. But nobody ever brings that up. And Putin said the other day, are you stupid? Don't you understand I have nukes? I could throw them at Ukraine any day. So this is the sort of background that we're living in. And so any local action seems to me to be well-timed right about now.
It does. We've got to keep the focus on because it truly is up to us, the citizens, to remedy this. Government officials are not going to do it. Nobody else is going to step in and do it. So it's doing actions like Liam did with his colleagues. It's doing actions like the War Crimes Tribunal. Today, in New London, Connecticut, a number of activists were outside the submarine base, and we're trying to draw attention to the nuclear submarines there. So everybody is going to have to keep the pressure on. And I think something Philip Berrigan demonstrated was you don't have to be an extraordinary individual to do this, a mythic or legendary individual. All of us have within us the ability to do something, to change the narrative, to plant the seeds, to influence peaceful and just change. And we're going to have to do that because, as you say, nuclear weapons now are an enormous threat, probably more so than even during the Cold War. These weapons that are built now, the nuclear weapons, are smaller yield, so it means they may be more likely to be used in a battle because it's not the large bombs that we were once working with. And they're talking about integrating nuclear warfare with conventional warfare and not have that wall between the two that always existed previously. So using a nuclear weapon would just be another tool in the toolbox of militaries to use. That's a terrifying thought. Mm-hmm. And that's something we're going to have to work hard to confront and to stop.
Liam, I have a question for you. It seems to me that one of the problems is this whole notion, I mean, of an eye for an eye. An eye for an eye. That's how it meant in the Middle East. It was, there's a whole history of the Palestinians. But the initial cause, or effect, you could say, of the trouble, horrible slaughter there now, was the attack by Hamas on Jews. And so the Jews said, as we said after 9/11, okay, you do that, I'm going to make it, I'm going to do it to you, and I'm going to make it 20 times worse, 100 times worse, and it's my right. And it's that mentality that is so frightening to people, or to me anyway, that desire for revenge, which it's in all of us, obviously it's in all of us. But surely you would think, after all these years of warfare, if we haven't learned anything, we should learn that escalation doesn't end until diplomacy. So why not start the diplomacy now?
Yeah. Well, I think that we have learned over our activities the last two or three months related to this Iden plant. We've learned that the resort to violence is so quick and so thorough and so unstoppable almost. And people assume that, for instance, that Israel has the right of self-defense. Well, they do have the right of self-defense, but they've gone far beyond anything that would be a self-defense against what happened to their people on October 7th of last year. And the amount of weaponry and the use of it in urban populations and in refugee centers in Gaza is just, it's beyond even revenge. And that's because people get caught up in it and they can't go. One of the things that surprised me is Erica Chenoweth, who Brad mentioned earlier, is having this study showing that that in more cases than not, nonviolence was the better course of action in terms of getting results. Well, Erica was a friend and a neighbor in Massachusetts a couple of years ago, and she confided in us that when she began the study, she assumed it was going to come out the other way. And she was actually in favor of a conclusion that would say that no, the military is more effective in reaching your goal. And she was surprised by her own research and almost converted herself, I mean, was converted herself to the tactics and strategies of nonviolent change rather than violent change. So it really has the, if you get in touch with the truth and pull away the sort of curtains from that are placed over the truth, a lot of times it has the capacity to change people right on the scene. And Erica has been a very, very strong voice for peace ever since she finished that study in 2013.
Interesting. Let me introduce you again. My guest tonight, today, I keep saying today and tonight, because I don't know when you're going to watch it. But anyway, I'm talking to Brad Wolf here in the studio, who is one of the conveners of the Merchants of Death War Crimes Tribunal. Whew, got it. And Liam Ramsey, who's a longtime peace activist, who's at the Kirk Ridge Retreat Center in the Poconos. So how to get from here to there? And to go back to the notion of silence, one of the things about the Ukraine war, the war, what's going on, our newfound antagonism with China and Russia. After, in the early 90s, we were talking about peace conversion, and what was it called? The peace dividend at the time. Mm-hmm. That was going to happen. But no, why did that not happen? Because the cynical, and I suspect true, assumption or conclusion was that the arms industry just needed to gin up another war, and so who was worth fighting it? So, well, Iraq, that's easy. Besides, they've got nuclear weapons. Did we know they didn't have nuclear weapons? I would imagine we probably did. And then after that was over, suppose, what about, who else can we set our sights on? And I'm sure the origins of the war in Ukraine are way too complicated to go into it in any event. But it is convenient for the weapons manufacturer to have a situation in which lots and lots of their weapons are used. And so, okay, so that, we assume that's going to be over. So then the Russia is a bogeyman, and now China. And it was interesting, another thing in the Pilcher thing was this treaty between the US government and Papua New Guinea, mm-hmm. to have Papua New Guinea have their ports and airfields open to US military. And so if you look at the bases now from Australia, New Zealand, Papua New Guinea, Indonesia, Philippines, on and on and on, I mean, China is absolutely stuck in a corner, surrounded by US bases. Mm-hmm. Can we possibly imagine that we would have no reaction? I mean, just look what happened in Cuba, or Grenada, for God's sake.
Right.
Big powers are paranoid. It's just the way they are. And it serves weapons manufacturers' interests to keep that going.
Yeah, there are, if I can just interject, there are 200 U.S. military bases encircling China right now. And of course, the unfunny joke is how dare China put its country so close to our bases, right?
Yeah.
But we can only imagine how the United States would respond if there were 200 Chinese or Russian bases off of our coast in Canada or Mexico or anything of the kind. We made it clear during the Cuban Missile Crisis that anybody who comes into the Western Hemisphere risks nuclear annihilation. But yet, we continue to edge closer and closer to China with our military bases, and closer to Russia with the expansion of NATO, something we promised we would not do. But now, nuclear missiles in NATO countries right on the Russian border. So this is not to be an apologist for Putin or for President Xi in China, but it's to be a realist and state the obvious that when the U.S. continues to expand and put its bases right up against these countries, there's going to be a reaction, and we are ginning it up for war, and it is in the benefit of weapons manufacturers to do that.
Right.
There are over 700 bases around the world, U.S. bases around the world. So it's really indicative what happens when you assign yourself the role as the leader of the world, and then you think you need to, in fact, make the world conform to your interests. And one of the ways to do that is by placing bases all over the world and to make sure that your way of seeing the world is the way that others around the world will see you. I mean, and we don't, like you say, we don't have time to go into the whole issue of NATO and where it came from and where it may be going, but it is, I think, indicative of an empire to have bases around the world, and it's our insistence on that and our insistence on the right to have those bases. I have a friend, Joe Gerson, who I worked with AFSC, and he wrote a book called The Sun Never Sets, which is about the American bases around the world. And it's an older book now, but it was instrumental for me in understanding the network of militarism that we have imposed on the rest of the world. Since World War II, particularly, but even before that.
Well, the euphemism, I think, is the rules-based order, international rules-based order, is the euphemism for saying we do it our way.
Right. We make the rules. What the rules are.
Right. And how do we start to talk peace? How do we get Ukraine? I mean, Blinken is working hard. You can certainly say that about him. He's working hard. But Biden is from the generation of the rules-based order, definitely. And he is not going to let that disappear. And yet, if we're going to make any progress on climate change, we have to become more cooperative. We can't have a top dog. At least that's my opinion.
It's true, and the U.S. military is the biggest institutional polluter in the world. So climate change and war, they go hand in hand, right? One is feeding the other. So as we're fighting one, we're really fighting both. We need to deal with climate change. More of our resources are going to need to be committed to dealing with climate change. Less of our resources need to be committed to dealing with war preparation. So confronting those facts is important. But we can make this happen, and I'd want to talk about hope in this interview, too, because we need to reflect on the fact that it was nonviolence that ended segregation in the South, which people said could never happen. It was nonviolence that ended the Vietnam War, and it was nonviolence that brought about the change in governments of many Eastern former Soviet bloc countries when the Cold War ended. So it can happen. We can do it here. We can stop the militarism and this race toward doomsday that the United States is on. It's through conversations like this that we make it happen. It's through war tribunals. It's through actions like Liam does. If you look at the conversation about Gaza right now, the enormous pressure that's been put on the Biden administration has raised that to make it a major issue. Had the people not come out in hundreds of thousands, it wouldn't be that. So it's, again, it is up to us to do it. It's up to the citizens.
Mm-hmm. Liam, we've just got a couple of minutes left. Do you have any parting thoughts on how to get to peace?
Well, I think we have to be true to our deepest feelings and our deepest hopes, as Brad was just saying. We can't let the immensity of the military-industrial complex weigh on us in a way that we reflect more despair than we do hope. And I think it's really important for the United States government and the people of the United States to insist that our government have a more cooperative relationship with the rest of the world, and less of this dominance and more stepping back and listening to the rest of the world and what they want. I mean, I was so moved by the fact that South Africa took Israel to court. And it was such a beautiful thing to watch a country that had been through so much itself and a people who have been through so much risk their international identity by calling for an indictment of the Israeli government for its attack on Gaza. That to me is a hopeful kind of sign that out of the ashes of apartheid has come this new entity which is able to see truth and to act on behalf of it and has the hope that it will succeed.
Very good. Well, wonderful, actually. So we're going to end it now, but I do want to say that I hope that you will tell your friends to participate in peace actions. It's scary sometimes to begin with. It's certainly not scary to stand with a sign on the Penn Street Bridge. And the final note should go to Brad and the website for
the Merchants of Death. So it is merchantsofdeath.org. Please go there. You can register to receive the weekly videos. They're only 25 to 30 minutes, but they're very informative and they will help you with this debate. So merchantsofdeath.org.
Thank you very much for watching, and goodbye.
Centering on Peace on BCTV is supported in part by the Berks Peace Community.